With us here on Market Guru, we're in conversation with Mr. Balasubramanian of Birla Sun Life. So thanks so much for being with us. Bala, themes, what are you tracking right now? Because it's a little confusing at the moment with everything kind of taking a little bit of a breather. Defensives have run up so much. Cyclicals are really lagging in terms of catching up with regards to the investment cycle or earnings. So what would you at this point advise?
Yeah, I think it's interesting. I think if you look at the whole market in the last few months, wherever there is a high valuations, but with a strong balance sheet, very strong free cash flows, true, high dividend paying track record, they're all trading at high PE multiples, and they were actually lagging behind with from the broader market perspectives. Okay. At the same time, cyclicals, which of course have been running behind in terms of performance quite significantly, they all have caught on quite well. I think we are now reached a stage, both the cyclicals and the asset-backed companies, as well as on the consumer-driven companies, all are now reached certain levels. Now it is the time actually for looking at the bottom-up stock picking approach, which of course most of the times we do that. At the same times, sometimes we need to also play a theme because of the undervaluations or discount, actually the substantial discount to the market, etc. And now we have now reached a stage. It's not the question of a theme, which I think one has to look at it. One has to look at actually what the kind of opportunities the markets are giving. I'll give you some few examples. For example, the export-driven companies, they continue, of course, benefit not only out of the rupee dollar being very, very strong, they also benefit out of the global economy picking up. Okay. So you see actually the certain kind of trend emerging. But that's not related to the theme, but it ultimately is related to the, one, relative valuation to the broad market, and second is what are the earnings surprise that could come as we move forward in terms of the numbers. Mm-hmm. As long as the earnings surprise are going to come, purely on the basis of the visibility that the companies, I think, will be able to actually generate, automatically, I think, those stocks actually become actually the buying opportunities. That's what we look at in terms of building the portfolio.
Yeah, since you mentioned about earnings from a stock-specific point of view, what's the general expectation? Is this quarter going to be something which is going to probably replicate what we saw last time around? You're expecting it to be a muted one, and probably the pickup's going to be, you know, towards the second half of this fiscal. What are your expectations when we talk about this earnings season?
I think the way we see is we will probably see an improvement.
Okay.
I think clearly one of the areas where we had a high level of belief that most of the Indian companies the last 2 to 3 years have really managed the balance sheet quite well, either in the form of cutting the debt or in the form of reducing the cost and so on and so forth. And clearly we are at a stage where if the economy starts picking up, the number of companies will surprise actually the analyst expectations, I think will be far, far higher.
Okay.
I think one of the expectations which we have, I think broad market, the question which always comes from the valuations.
Yeah.
But the valuation is something which is always debatable. It's something which will never get a right answer. At the same time, the valuations, if it is actually looked at in conjunction with an expectation on the growth, then definitely I think the valuation is justifiable.
Okay.
At the same time, the kind of expectation that is now getting built up on earnings upgrades, if that continues to remain good, then the broad market also will get comfort on the valuation.
But just very quickly, are there specific sectors, you know, where that applies? In the sense that we've had earnings kick off with an INFI and an RIL both delivering.
True.
So there's not really been any disappointment. But there could be some pockets of the market where we are expecting to see that disappointment. Would you be able to point out where you're not really hoping to see too much?
I think clearly, I think one of the risks, I think, from the market point of view is the expectations are high. And definitely the... which also reflects on the stock price, it reflects on the overall market sentiment. I think clearly if there is a bit of delay in terms of the growth coming back, I think definitely the expectation that we are getting in terms of the return on, rather the results expectations, which is likely to actually be better actually in the coming quarter, maybe get postponed one more quarter.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the broad disappointments, I think in our view, will be relatively lower.
Okay.
I think the number of companies which I think surprise the market, I think, will be far, far higher. And also, we need to still look at it, given the fact that so far, we've not seen any kind of rate cut, and we've not got any signal in terms of rate cut coming down. I mean, rather the interest rates coming down. I think, clearly, if you look at the bond market, the way it behaves, the way the interest rate swap market has been behaving, there has been a substantial drop.
But
the five-year interest rate swaps have dropped almost
1%. But the cost of funding has come down.
Yes.
That's what they're arguing. You don't need a rate cut at this point. Because one could argue that that's what the banking sector at this point is saying, that who needs a rate cut when they're already cutting deposit rates? How would you play banking then? Because the infra theme all comes down to where the financing comes in.
Correct.
How would you now see the banking sector, which will feel the brunt of, you know, the rates being sticky at that end, but cost of funding coming down, but nobody borrowing at this point?
True. I think the whole banking sector is something which is, the way we have been playing is, there are three different segments of the market, which is, because you're retail, you're wholesale funding, yeah, as well as a wholesale deposit bank. I think clearly if you look at it from the broader market point of view, the retail loans books have been pretty, very strong.
Okay.
And then the growth continues to remain very strong, and we're also looking at the pickup in the commercial vehicle sales, and the pickup in the two-wheelers, to pick up in the car sales. All these things have to reflect on the banking industry's growth.
Okay.
And having said that, I think wholesale market is the one which have most of the time takes a backseat, given the fact that the current NPL levels in the banking systems have still not come to a level which is more acceptable.
Okay.
And we still not got any kind of visibility how the NPAs will change.
So
we still not got any kind of comfort that how the existing NPAs, I think, will perform as we move forward, etc. I think given that kind of fact, we'll probably see wherever we are taking a bet on cyclical recovery, we may probably get delayed.